of China Inside Out. I must say a big thank you to Julia Lovell, who chaired the first session brilliantly. I'm sure those of you who read the programme properly and know Julia's work realise she's actually one of our leading scholars on Chinese literature. So it's a real honour for us to have had her here this morning to share. I'm afraid I'm not one of Britain's leading scholars in Chinese literature, but I am very committed to the principles of freedom of expression. And for that reason, I'm particularly pleased to welcome our speakers for this session, Jian and Li Jianhong, two writers who, unlike Fu Ning and Chen Jiwa earlier, have now left China, perhaps permanently. Two writers who would have enormous difficulty in ever returning to live and work inside that country. And two writers for whom censorship is not a complex, nuanced issue of self-censorship or of finding an accommodation with a regime. Two writers for whom censorship is a very real lived experience of exile, almost the most definitive and final top-down form of censorship, of a ban on someone expressing themselves that it's possible to imagine. So we're delighted that they can both be here today to take the discussion onwards through the morning before this afternoon you start talking to some writers in real intimacy in the smaller workshops. But I wanted to begin really by asking both of you, Ma Jian and Li Jianhong, to tell us a little bit about yourselves and about your journey out of China. And perhaps, Ma Jian, we begin with you because your journey began slightly longer ago.
He's so glad to see so many people in here when it's such a beautiful sunny day outside. A great sacrifice.
这使我想起，就是说我离开了中国差不多将近快二十年了。
I have left China. It's now almost 20 years.
那么在这么长的一个时间里，我作为一个中国作家。 对伦敦或者对这个中国的看法，可能是完全跟在国内的作家是不一样的。So
this distance, this has probably given me a very different perspective on China than those writers who have remained
there.我还记得我最早，作为一个第一篇小说吧，是叫《亮出你的舌苔》出版的时候，那个时候整个的这本书就被查封了。 查封的时候，其实我那个时候已经到了香港，所以没有太大风险。When
my first novella was published,
87年是吧？嗯，87年。In
1987, called "Stick Out Your Tongue," novella about Tibet. By that time, I had actually, by the time that it was published and then officially banned by the government, I had then moved to Hong Kong, so I didn't feel I didn't experience the dangerous implications of that ban in person.
但是我没有想到，因为这么一篇小说28000字，它完全改变了我的命运，我以后的这个名字和作品就很难再在。
So, and I had no conception, I had no realization, understanding at the time, that this very slim novella, 28,000 words only, would completely alter my fate, my destiny. It would lead to a permanent ban of my works in China, and that from then on, not even my name could be mentioned.
那么我们不得不看，就是今天的中国社会对于这个住在海外的这样的作家，到底是一个什么样的态度呢？什么？今天的社会，今天，对这些在我这样的作家会。So
I wonder now how exile writers such as myself viewed in China.
我举这个例子，跟欧宁的一种合作，我觉得比较有意思。 我曾经给他2个月以前传了一首诗，非常长的一首诗，但是到了他那里，很快的他就回答我说，后面还有一个部门，就是不敢发，也不是不敢发这个诗，是不敢发马甸这个名字。
So just one very recent example that comes to mind, owning asked for a contribution from me for his journal recently. So I sent a poem, which he said he liked, but then the answer came back later that it wouldn't be allowed to be published, not because of the work itself, but just because of my name. My name itself puts an end to all possibility of publication.
我记得奥运的期间，我还可以回到中国，然后顶多是北京市的公安局。 江处长会找我谈话，让我不准见刘晓波，但是我还是可以进到中国。
Up until 2010, and certainly within the during the time of the Olympics, I was up from the time I left in 1987 till 2010. I was able to return freely with. The most that would happen would be that I would be called in for a meeting with the Public Security Bureau. They would warn me not to meet with any sensitive people such as Liu Xiaobo and not to not to speak to foreign journalists. But up until that time I returned frequently and for long periods of time.
但是从去年因为我的书出了中文版，大家注意中文版跟英文版出。 在中国是可能是完全两个不同的概念，因为你出了英文书，可能没有人管，共产党那些领导们他们可能也不知道什么叫英文，他们也不懂。但是你出了中文版，这个事情就麻烦了，他们会想到你的书会影响到他们，所以出了英文版，从此以后我进海关就被拒绝了。
But since last summer, when the Chinese edition of Beijing Coma was the original edition was published and quite widely distributed in Taiwan and Hong Kong. Up until then, my books had mostly the Chinese censors don't care about publications in English. Most of them can't read it. It's out of their
off their radar.
But once this the Chinese edition had made a bit more impact, since then I have been since last summer I have not been allowed to return.
那么在中国，我觉得让一个作家的消失，它主要是从这个先从你这个人要消失。
In China, if the authorities want to make a writer disappear, it's not the works that they only want to obliterate. It's the person. It's the physical being itself.
那么我记得我的名字，如果上了中国的网站，如果你点一下马健的话，可能出来的就变成了罗马建筑。So
his if you type in his name Ma Jian in Chinese, because of the way the internet is sensitive in China, it will the results will come up as Roman architecture or something. There will be some very.
昨天我点了我的书，叫那个大家看正在卖的叫《北京植物人》。我如果点到《北京植物》，你还可以这个页面可以显示。但是如果《北京植物》后边再加了一个人，他就告诉你这个页面是违法的，我们不提供。So
I typed in last night. I typed in the name of my novel Beijing Coma in Chinese, and as I could get as far as Beijing. Cut the next word in half, and then I would get lots of results coming back. But as soon as the whole name came up, it was just a blank message saying, sorry, there are no results for this.
但是有一点非常重要，就是我会发现，在中国流亡的这个作家，跟这个中国作家之间的关系其实是非常紧张的，他们并没有一种沟通的一种渠道，这种渠道也是非常微妙的。
There is the situation now is that there is a very difficult relationship, a difficult relationship between Chinese writers within China and the exile writers. There's a sort of uncomfortable sense of discomfort.
你会发现很多作家朋友，我有很多朋友，我们可以在一起聊天，可以说话，但是一说到 能否在中国出你的小说，这变成大家都要沉默一下，因为这可能就要冒一些政治风险。
你是说
出版？出版。
So I can sit down and have dinner with editors and publishers in China and have extremely open, friendly discussions. But as soon as the subject of the possibility of my books being published there crops up, suddenly everyone goes silent.
我记得我跟一些出版社的朋友也合作过，比如说我改过我的名字，我叫马建刚，我也出版过我的这个The Noodle Make 的那个拉面者。
So I have tried to find avenues, ways to get my books published in China. One time I managed to find one independent publisher who would publish The Noodle Maker, as long as I changed my name.
但是很快这本书也现在见不到了。
But very shortly that 什么时候见不到？
就是出版一个星期以后就。
A week after it was published, the books vanished from the bookshelves.
So can I just interrupt briefly, and then I want to bring in Li Xiaopong. It sounds like for you, Ma Shan, the initial problem for the Chinese authorities was about the content of what you were writing, that you were writing about Tiananmen Square, or about the pro-democracy movement, or elements in Chinese history which people would prefer not to be remembered. But you yourself, you, your name, your person has now become kind of totemic of an attitude which the Chinese government would like to suppress. Is that right?
就本来他们不喜欢你，他们就是你的你写的内容，你的小说本身。但是现在就是你本，他们不喜欢，就是你本人，你本人代表的一种心态，是一种符号性的。是不是这个？他们现在反对，他们现在就怕你这个人代表的一种思想。
准确的来描述我这个人跟中国政府的关系，可能就是这样。他们把我当成了用了中国常用的一个词，这个人搞政治。
So I perhaps the relationship between me and the Chinese state, they have labeled me as some political troublemaker.
那么这个词的背后，我们可以翻译过来。准确的是，他认为你这个人有独立的思想。
But what they are truly, but behind this, what they are truly afraid of is that of somebody who has wants to express their individual thoughts, independent thoughts.
在中国的报纸，我们常见到的一个词就叫与这个，或者叫党中央，或者叫与党保持一致。
In the Chinese newspapers, you will often come across this term that writers should be at one with the party, in unison with the party. Their thoughts should be.
这点中国的官方作家一定要具备这个条件，他们其实在与党是保持一致的。
So any published writer in China will feel this pressure to conform to that very uniform way of thought.
也许他们有一点小的动作。说话稍微有一点出格，有一点批评，但是整体上来讲，他们是没有机会跟这个党成为一种对立的关系，这是非常危险的，因为这么做。
So perhaps there will be opportunities with them. They will have opportunities to make small criticisms, to step a little bit outside that box. But when it, but as a whole, they have to agree to stay within these state-imposed confines. And anyone who steps outside and who stands up in opposition to that regime will have a very different fate.
所以严格的来讲，作家本来是跟这个文学并没有跟这个文学和政治并没有发生那么大的关系。但是由于他把你放到了这么一个角色里面，你不得不知道政治是什么。
So perhaps a writer might start out with no political, not think of himself or herself as a political writer, but having stepped outside transgressed those lines, they will inevitably find themselves categorized into, put placed in that category, and will also become that person out of necessity.
Let me now bring in Li Jianhong. Li Jianhong, you're not a novelist like Ma Shan. You've written and edited blogs, and you've written more factual, journalistic style of writing. Tell us a little bit about your own journey out of China and why you found yourself living in Sweden as you now do.
好的，嗯，很高兴今天呢在这里和我的我尊敬的文学前辈马健老师一起呢和大家一起分享关于写作、关于生活的一些经验体验。
I'm very happy to be here, and I'm quite honored to be sitting with Ma Jian, who I admire very much.
那马健老师对于我来说可以说是文学方面的前辈老师。他是从80年代起呢就在写小说，而且就发表过在国内很有影响的小说。但是我实际上不是个专业作家出身，就是比如说在2001年之前，我都不是一个专业作家。
Ma Jian is certainly a well-known writer. And,
sorry, there's been a request. Can you speak up a bit?
Of course. My apologies.
Thank you.
Mr. Ma Jian is he's known to be a person in the literature circles, and especially in the former generation of Chinese writers. He's a very important writer. He started writing in the 80s, and so his influence is extremely large. I, on the other hand, am not a professional writer, and I didn't start writing until 2000.
那我后面谈一下我介入写作的经历。我介入写作呢，主要是2000年以后我开始上网，然后我网上当时就大家知道有那个 BBS 的互动是可以讨论的，所以我就在网上呢发表一些文章，就主要对中国的一些可能热点的社会事件啊、社会问题，提出我自己的一些观点看法。
And so let me explain a little bit about how I got to writing. Starting in 2000, I started to use the internet, and I like to write on the bulletin board systems, kind of like an area where you can say your opinions online. And I started to write articles on this BBS system. I wrote about social events and also social problems.
那在我记忆当中呢，中国对互联网的管制，就是直到2003年、04年之前是相对宽松的，因为当时互联网是一个新出现的，可以说是新生事物。那政府一时没有反应过来，就是该怎么样去控制它，或者是不知道它有什么样的影响力，所以没有像对传统出版界那样严厉控制。
At that time, the situation in China was a little bit different, and probably all the way up until 2003 or 2004, it was more open.That's because the internet was a bit of a new thing, and the government did not know how to react to it, and it did not know how it could effectively control it. More importantly, it wasn't sure about the influence of the government, the influence of the internet, and how much control would be needed.
所以当时，我们网友在网上像这种 BBS， 还有后来出现的博客呢，那就有相对的有一些比较自由的讨论空间。比如说我们当时可以讨论中国那个历史上的一些问题，像文革、反右，那包括六四，就89年的民主运动，也可以隐晦的提到。
And so at that time, we were a little bit more free. We could speak on the BBS websites, we could speak on blogs later, and we could even talk about historical events. We could talk about the Cultural Revolution or the anti-rightist movement or even Tiananmen Square.
我在2002年的时候也尝试和有共同兴趣的朋友呢自己创办主持过网站，就是这种 BBS 讨论。
2002年。In 2002, I even made a website with some friends. We created our own BBS chat website.
那我当时在网络上发表文章是用笔名或者叫做网名，就是不是我身份证上登记的名字。
At that time, I used a pseudonym, and I did not use my own name online.
但是呢，还是因为我在网上发表了一些触及敏感话题的文章，那警察最后在2004年发现我，就开始来调查我。
However, since I was always talking about sensitive topics, starting in 2004, the police and the government started to watch me and see what I was writing.
那当时2004年是89年的六四事件15周年，我和朋友主持的那个 BBS 呢就在15周年前夕被封掉。
In 2004, we celebrated the 15th anniversary of the Tiananmen Square incident, and so on the BBS website, we were all of a sudden, our website was completely blocked.
警察也最早在那个时候找我谈过话，但是一开始的方式是相对比较温和、比较礼貌的，就是对我提出来一些劝告，劝我有什么看法、有什么问题可以直接找他们沟通，说他们通过合适的渠道可以向上级反映，让我就是你不要随便就在网上发表那种文章嘛，就是你老看社会的阴暗面，这样呢会对社会大众产生影响，会有不利的影响。
And at the beginning, the police would talk to me, and they were actually very polite and kind. Usually, they would talk to me in the form of suggestions, and they would tell me that, you know, maybe I should write a little bit less on the internet, or maybe I should talk to the police before I write something online, and not just directly write things. If I was always talking about negative things that happened in society, or problems in society, then that could have a large influence, and that would not be helpful.
那可能是因为我没有听从他们的劝告，就是继续在网络上碰触一些敏感的话题。这样从2005年开始，他们对我的措施就升级，也跑到我当时工作的公司去调查，导致我失去工作。And
unfortunately, I didn't listen to their suggestions. So starting in 2005, they stepped up their actions and became more harsh. At that time, the police came to the place where I worked to have an investigation, and it caused me to lose my job.
那当时我居住的城市是上海，就相对还是中国比较大的，应该感觉各方面还算是先进的一个城市。但是我仍然感觉到当时的压力很大，就是我2005年失业以后呢，在本地找工作会受到干预。这样我就试图换到南方的一个城市，就靠近香港。我认为那里呢，因为靠近香港受到就港澳的一些影响，可能会相对自由些。但是我在那里找了两份工作，都被警察的干预给就是失去了。
At that time, I was living in Shanghai, which is a big city and rather modernized. However, I was feeling the pressure and I couldn't find any job there. Ever since 2005, the government would always affect my ability to find a job. And for that reason, I decided to move. I moved to Shenzhen, which is closer to Hong Kong, and I thought that maybe it would be more open. However, two times I found a job and two times I lost my job because the police got involved.
那他们本来是不让我写文章，对我采取这些措施，但是他们又逼着我，就是就不让我找工作，那我又没有其他的生存方式，所以我当时就只有继续写文章在海外发表，这样我可以得到一些稿费维持生活。那因此呢，又不断的被他们干扰，就是包括一些短期的拘押，有时候所谓的敏感时期，他们会把我监禁在家里，就 house arrest， 大概一两个星期这个样子，不准我随便外出，不准我见其他的朋友。
And so I knew that they would not allow me to write, but I had no idea that they would force me to not be able to find work. Of course, I need to have work to survive, so at that time I continued to write, and I published outside of China in order to get money from that and to survive. However, the situation got worse and worse, and the police continued to come to my house. Sometimes they put me under house arrest, sometimes for 2 weeks at a time, where I was not able to go out and I was not able to see any friends.
Can I ask a question at this point? Because in the first session we talked about the sometimes arbitrary and surprising nature of censorship. I'm interested to know from Li Jianhong, around this time, was it very clear to her which topics were going to get her in trouble and which topics she might get away with? Or was it mysterious and surprising?
我可以举一些例子，比如说，2003年的时候，大家可能还有点记忆，在中国有一场疫情，就 SARS。 那么，由于政府一开始初期呢是隐瞒疫情，所以造成了不必要的生命和财产的损失。那我和其他的网友在网上呢，也就对这个事情发表自己的看法。另外，像也是同一年，有一个大学生叫申志刚，那么他当时在广东街头被警察查身份证，因为他的身份证没有带在身上，这样就被警察送到拘留所去。 就被活活打死，那这个事件当时造成的影响也很恶劣，就讨论类似的话题就碰触官方的禁忌。
Let me give you two examples of information that would cause you to get followed by the police. In 2003, SARS broke out and the government was trying to hide its existence. That caused a lot of losses and a lot of resources to be wasted. And so I wrote an article about that. That was something that the government got mad about. There was another event that happened in Guangdong. A man named Sun Zhigang was asked by the police to show his ID. However, he couldn't find it. So he was brought to another place and he was beaten to death. I wrote an article about that, and that also caused trouble.
So it's pretty clear. So examples of state corruption or state incompetence were pretty likely to get you in trouble.
应该说我可以知道吧，就比如说你如果在网上，像如果是女性的写作者，比如你如果是专门去写一些风花雪月的啊，就是男女情爱的这些方面的，你不涉及其他敏感的社会问题、政治性的话题，可能不会有什么问题。
I guess at that point I was pretty aware. If I, you know, as a female writer, if I wrote about love between a man and a woman and nothing else and no politics, I knew that I would be fine.
Right. Was that ever a temptation?
我在学生时代的时候写过一些很浅显的那种，就可以说算是情诗吧，这还有类似的散文这些，但是很久没有写类似的题材了。
When I was a student, I wrote some love stories, and just, you know, a little, but I don't write anything like that anymore.
And then just before we come back to Marjan, just a little bit about the most recent, the last couple of years, when this barrier on your return to China has been put in place.�
我也可以补充一点信息，就是我在网上关心这个话题有一个思想渊源，是因为1989年民主运动的时候，我是一个上海的大学生，那我当年卷入这个运动，这个运动的结局就当时因为我还比较年轻，对于我的伤害很大，也从此可以说改变了我日后的人生道路和人生选择。
Actually, I'd like to back up really quick. In 1989, I was a student during the Tiananmen Square incident, and I participated in it. So I was harmed very much by what happened in that event, and that event completely changed my life.
那我们回到主持人刚才问题，您是想了解就是警察现在在国内的一些变化，自己的生活，5年之后是怎么？我自己的生活。OK，然后就刚才说到的，就是警察骚扰真的持续了2-3年。那2008年的时候，我在的中文笔会就给我联系了一次出国访问的机会，就通过那个 ICO，就是机构，到Stockholm去做驻事作家。我是2008年4月到Stockholm。
So for 3 years, I was constantly pestered by the police up until about 2008. At that time, Chinese PEN, a writing society, contacted me and said that I would have a chance to go to Sweden. And it was through a program called ICOLON, which supports refugees who like to live abroad. And so in April of 2008, I had the opportunity to go to Stockholm, Sweden.
那当时我在Stockholm，我就作为驻事作家，待了1年半，是 Stockholm 市文化部给我资助。那1年半之后呢，2009年的10月份，我结束这个访问作家的访问。我的个人的计划是回中国的，就虽然回中国我会面临一些困难，一些困扰，但是我认为呢。 作为一个中文写作者，我的主要的读者群在中国国内，另外我关注的一些问题也是跟中国密切相关，所以我还是希望返回我自己的国家，而且我有亲人和很多朋友在那里。So
at that point, I was a guest writer in Sweden, and that program lasted for 1.5 years. It was supported by the Swedish Cultural Ministry. And after it ended, I had planned to return to China. I knew that if I lived in China, I would be, you know, dealing with a lot of problems, and I would, you know, I wouldn't have maybe the most comfortable life, but I knew that I wanted to write about China, and I knew that the people that I wanted to be involved with, the writing groups, etc., were all in China. And I was hoping that I could get back to China as well as just be with my family and be with my friends.
当时我先订去香港的机票，就是去香港见几个朋友，然后我从深圳那里入关，就在深圳海关那里两次被拒绝入境。我当时拿的是有效中国护照。
So I took a plane and went to Hong Kong, and I tried to enter China through the Shenzhen port. However, twice I was not allowed to enter China, and even though I was carrying a Chinese passport, I was not allowed to enter China.
那我问他们入境处什么原因？就是他们就意思说上面不让你入境，就没有给我任何解释、任何原因。我问他们能不能给我一个书面的处理决定，这一些他们也都一概拒绝。
At that point, I asked them why they would not allow me to enter the country, and they said, the higher-ups are saying you're not allowed to come into China. And I said, could you please give me a written explanation? And they still would not give me any explanation.
所以后来我在香港待了几天之后就没办法，我就又返回瑞典。那现在我在瑞典的身份是政治难民。
I waited in Hong Kong for a few days and realized that the situation would not change, so I had no choice but to return to Sweden.I currently live in Sweden as a refugee.
Thank you very much, Jianhong. And I'd like to ask a bit more about that experience in a moment. Perhaps I'll return to Marjan first. Marjan, you've been living in Britain now for some time. You put down deep roots, you have a family here. And I'm sure there are many, many pleasures to being able to write freely. But I wonder also, is there a part of you that would really like to return to China, or which finds it problematic to be writing in the West?Perhaps for a Western market, about a country which is so many thousands of miles away and where you haven't been able to spend time or long periods of time for so long.
Wow. 我当然想回去，因为作为一个中文作家的话，第一我要跟那个社会发生一种关系。
Of course, I want to go back as a Chinese writer. I need to keep this relationship alive between me between myself and the society I write about.
因为当然了，在英国，当然我感受到这种自由，这种自由让我完全把自己的这个思想都可以打开，在文学的这个叙述方面，在文学的描述方面，我没有任何禁忌。
Of course, I.Deeply appreciate being able to live in England and be able to write with complete freedom and to be able to to open myself up while during the writing process and feel no constraints whatsoever.
我在之前呢，其实当然我现在有四个孩子，回去非常麻烦。但是在这之前，我是差不多每年都回去。
So now I have four young children, so it's any kind of travel is problematic. But before then, I would go back regularly for long periods of time every year. I would be continually returning.
但是最大的一个问题就是说，一个作家，你在另一个国家，然后反过头来你要写那个社会，这里边有一个怎么说呢？有一种距离感。
Being in England and writing about China, it does give me that a perspective, a sense of distance, a sense of separation.
但是我认为这种东西吧，可以从两个角度来看。一个角度，你作为一个流亡在外的作家，你可能反过头来看那个社会，看得更清楚。
Perhaps this is the beneficial side of this is that this distance gives you a sense of clarity when you look back at the country you're writing in.
特别是像这种互联网时代，我甚至都要告诉我妈妈，她住的青岛的那条街道上有个车撞了。
And in this computer age, I am able to tell my mother that there's been a car crash two streets down from her.
我也要经常告诉
她。
并且呢，我也要经常告诉她哪些食品不要吃，最近又发现了是有毒的。
and I often advise her about tell her about the latest information on which products, food products you shouldn't eat, which are toxic, which are.
其实我在外面，我感觉到我比中国人在国内的人的获得的信息量要大好多倍。
I feel I have access to a great deal more information than Chinese people within China do. I feel that is.
这对于写作本身是一个好处。
This is all helpful for the writing process.
然后我们还说另一面的作家，他由于这个被变成了一个流亡作家。 他很可能就被消失了，被另一个文化消失了。
But another danger for a writer in exile is that they will vanish. They will be consumed within the culture that they move to.
因为从流亡的概念来讲上，他把你从一个国家赶出来，他的目的是让你不存在了。
And that is the aim of these regimes, the regimes that force writers into exile. Their hope, their aim of this process is for you to disappear.
那这种感觉，我觉得很像是那个鲁滨逊，当他有两种可能，也可能死掉，也可能会被得救。
鲁滨逊一样，漂流记录。 Just like anyone stranded in a foreign place, like Robinson Crusoe, you will either perish or you will be rescued.
有一点比较重要，其实作家在写作的时候，主要是依靠了你的想象力，另外是你的生存的经验。这两点，你离开那个国家了，你还是在你身上。
But for a writer, everything that the tools that you have are inside you. Your imagination, the experiences you have lived. This is what you draw on when you write literature. So that they cannot take away.
因为你永远带着你的传统，带着你的语言，你走到哪里这些东西都丢不了。
They can't take away the language that you write with, your traditions, your memories.
当然，从另一个角度来看，英国人看我，我就是你们的星期五。
Perhaps you all look at me as your as a man Friday.
Are you the man Friday?
No.
But it just makes me wonder, Marjan, why you haven't written about this experience in your novels, in your wonderful novels of the last 20 years, Beijing Homer, Stick Out Your Tongue, Red Dust, and so on. I mean, you've consistently and insistently written about China. Often you seek to map China in your novels. He often takes these journeys, real or fictional journeys, or thinks about taking journeys. And you've been living here in London for all this time, and as far as I'm aware, you haven't written in fiction about that journey that you yourself have taken.
你那么多年，在外面你写的那些小说，都是写中国，都是你每次都是一种语境也好，像你画的中国的那种，你要写好像一定把它，你写之前都是写一种语境吧。但是你为什么到现在你没有写你以往的经验？你写为什么你还坚持？
一直在写中国。这个可能跟我的这个生活的经验有关系，因为我发现，其实我到死，我记忆里边的故事我都写不完。
It's probably from this feeling that I have that I have so many stories inside me that I could never write that I do not have enough days left in my life to be able to write them all.
因为当你在这个真正在写作的时候，你可能不太在乎外面的世界到底是一个什么样的，你更在乎你记忆里面你想象的那个场景。因为写作文学本身就是我要制造一个不同的世界。So
literature is about creating a different, an alternative universe, a different universe for yourself, and the universe that I return to. Or is my memories and China, and in fact, when I'm sitting down and writing, my surroundings become immaterial to the writing process. It's from
It's very interesting. So, I mean, Marjan obviously has been able to find access to a Western audience through your wonderful translations and the work of your publisher here. But Li Jianhong, as far as I know, you're still writing in Chinese for a Chinese readership inside China. They're a very long way away, those readers. What are the challenges of connecting with them and creating a shared experience through your writing?
马建先生他已经在西方有很多读者，很多人关注他，但也见到您在大部分的读者还住在中国，距离很大，那么您的读者离您很遥远，就距离很大，那么怎么跟他们建立联系？我至今只是在香港出版过两本书。另外一本呢是八九年六四二十周年前后的，我通过主要是通过电话和网络的方式采访当年的一些当事人，就当时选了十个人做采访的那个采访部整理出来，在香港出版的时候，《When I was in 1998》，我1998，这两本书呢都是没法在国内出版的，所以有时候我也很遗憾，就是因为香港出版的书很多，就包括这种，就主要是这种禁止的，不可能在大陆公开发行，那就最多就只有大陆的旅游者到香港可以买到。那我想现在，
I published two books so far through a publisher in Hong Kong. One was a collection of essays that I had written, and another was called My 1989. And it was actually a bunch of interviews that I had done via telephone and email, just asking them about their experiences of the Tiananmen Square incident, as well as some of my own experiences. So I've written two books thus far, but I do think that it's kind of a shame. If my books are only published in Hong Kong, then it's very difficult for any Chinese readers to be able to read them. Only people who can travel to Hong Kong are able to buy the book. So that actually means there's not very many people that can read those books.
那我现在我想跟国内读者见面的方式，更多的只能通过互联网吧。但是通常我发表的那些文章也不可能直接在国内的网站显示的，就是现在中国很多人都知道有一种翻墙软件，你用了可以翻出来看外面的网站。
So if I want to communicate with readers in China, usually I can only use the internet. However, I cannot directly post on websites that can be shown in China. So you usually have to use some special techniques like getting over the Great Firewall in order for Chinese readers to read what I write.
And there's another way in which I understand that you remain connected with writers in China, which is through your work for the Independent Chinese PEN Center, the ICPC. It'd be very interesting to hear a little bit about your role for ICPC and whether you think that work is making any difference. Is it really helping to protect writers in China or to promote freedom of expression in China?
2008年到国外之后呢，为我们独立中文笔会做了更多的一些工作，就参与更多。现在我是，我们笔会有一个专门的机构叫豫中作家委员会，是，主要是为国内因言获罪的作家提供一些帮助，在国际上呼吁声援。我现在是这个机构的协调人。
After I left China in 2008, I participated more and more in participated more and more in protecting writers in China and helping writers in China. We have a program that specifically gives aid to writers in China who are being persecuted.
当时我在国内的时候，就是具体参与笔会的工作比较有限。这个是国外的同仁对国内同仁的一种保护吧，就你直接介入太多，在国内会受到更大的压力。那我基本上是2009年确定就是回不去了，不能回国了，才成为笔会的专职工作人员。以前就是只是提供一些信息啊。
When I was was in China, my participation in this area was very limited. But when you're outside of China, then your participation can change. And now writers living in exile are more able to help writers who are still in China. After the incident in 2009, I realized that it would be very unlikely that I'd be able to come back to China anytime soon. And so I decided that I could play a bigger role in helping writers in China. And so now I play a more responsible role, and I'm more involved in helping these writers. I used to only give information, and now I'm actually the coordinator of the protection for these writers.
所以我认为我在国内受到的那些性质措施能包括我后来不能回国那主要处于中国对于我写作的一种报复当然我当时也是作为米会的会员这是一个附加的原因吧那后来因反正我已经回不去了那我国内的同仁他们可以说比我承受了更多付出代价更大他们很多人现在在监狱里我觉得有责任帮助他们所以我就在里面就当了。
Of course, the things that I can do is more limited, but now there's no way that I'm going back. The situation is different. I think that China has not allowed me to come back as a way to repay me for everything that I've written. Fortunately, at that time, I was already a member of ICBC, and since I knew that I couldn't come back, I decided that I could do a little bit more. And there's a lot of writers in China who are very smart, but they have paid even greater costs than I have. Some of them are in jail right now, and I think that I have a responsibility to help them.
Thank you very much. Marjan, I believe you're also involved in ICPC, and you've just been handing out details of some, I think these are imprisoned writers. Do you want to just tell everyone a bit about these particular cases?
This
is an extremely grave situation. The fact that so many Chinese writers are in prison at the moment. Many people know about the case of Liu Xiaobo, but there are many other colleagues of mine in China who are now in prison as well. And some of them, their details I've distributed.
我想之所以出现了这么一种很奇怪的情况，就是说，中国的文学怎么能变成了又是流亡文学，又是地下文学，又是民间文学，这是中国社会一个非常大的问题。
The fact that Chinese writing has now been divided into state officially approved state writing, unofficial underground writing, and then exile Chinese writing. One has to understand how this has come to be.
那么简单点说，这个你成为官方作家之后吧，你其实很像是一个在一个笼子里边的一个鸟。
Once you've become a state-approved writer, you're like a bird in a cage.
你的主人会给你很好吃的东西，你唱的可能也非常漂亮，你可能是全国嗓子最好的。Your
owner will give you delicious food to eat. You will sing, perhaps you will live quite happy. You will sing beautifully. You will gain prizes for your beautiful singing.
但是你会发现，这些官方的作家很快。 他们就认为他们这样的生活方式是非常优秀的，他们对笼子之外的作家是非常瞧不起的。The
problem arises is when these captive birds, these birds acquire a state of become very happy in this environment, become a sense of pride in their predicament, and then they look down on those writers who are outside that golden cage.
当然，我们不能说笼子里边的作家，他的写作的水平不高，他的文学不高，不是这个意思。他可能是中国的国宝。
I'm not saying that these writers aren't, or perhaps they are one, they are, many of them are wonderful writers. They have great literary skills. They are people who should be the national treasures.
但是我认为更重要的一点，作家或者文学这个行业，你必须反叛。
But I believe fundamentally that writers, literature should hold a sense of, should have within it that writers should have a sense of rebellion, a sense of
文学和艺术是绝对不能妥协的。
Literature and writers should not allow themselves to compromise.
因为人类之所以能够保留的文学艺术这种精神空间，就是靠了每一个个人的这种不妥协。
The reason why we have these great literary traditions, the works of art that have lasted, that have stood the test of time, is that they have been created by individuals who have refused to compromise.
我打开电脑想让大家看一个作家，可能太小了，没办法。
This photo is a bit small, but I just want to show you a picture of a writer. Many of you may not have heard of.
Okay, 变大一点，大家可以看，简单看一下他的脸。
You can see his face, I hope.
这是他那个死亡之前的一张脸。
This is the face. This is his face before he died.
这是他变成植物人临死之前的一个照片。
So that was 就是他进监狱之前的，
临死之前，
不是上一次那个，
这是临死之前，你看
一
下，
对，我就说上一次那个，
上一次
Okay, so the picture you saw initially of him looking very healthy was before he was imprisoned. This was 3 years after when he came out of prison and on his deathbed.
这个作家叫李红，他本身是浙江文学院的专业作家。
His name is Jianhong. He was a state-approved writer, member of the Zhejiang Writers Association.
他就是因为办了个叫爱琴海的网站，他也在网上经常发表写一些文章。
He was a poet and a writer, but he also opened a website called the Jian, on which he posted a political articles.
他被判了六年徒刑。
He was sentenced to 6 years in jail.
等他放出来的时候，公安局把他放出来的时候，他只有两个眼睛会动。
When he was released from jail, only his two eyes could move.
我们到现在也不知道他到底在监狱里受到了什么样的待遇。
We don't know what tortures he suffered within prison.
因为他什么也说不了。
Because he couldn't say a thing.
问题是放出来之后到监狱里死掉，警察的眼睛一直在看着他，没有人可以跟他说话。
But from the moment he was released and taken to the hospital where he later died, the police, the security officers, were continually watching those eyes, and no one was allowed to speak to him.
但是我只想告诉大家一点，就是他的诗歌非常优秀。
But I just want to tell you all, his poems are beautiful.
In that context, there's obviously a certain amount of controversy around the decision to invite China to be the market focus country at this year's London Book Fair. One of the arguments for that invitation, for the presence of some of those official Chinese writers on the programme, is that it may in time lead to greater freedom for those writers in China, perhaps because the state authorities see what a liberal publishing culture can do economically, and they want to take back some of those ideas to China and to open things up in China. Do you buy that argument?
Okay, 现在有书展开幕，他们本来说这样，你去中国的这里有一种交流的机会，你可以帮助中国变自由的。你同意这个意见吗？
呀，我知道下个月伦敦书展是中国年，在这个情况下，我只能这么来讲，与中国官方的这个中国政府的这个交往，当然这是官方的一种交往，但是必须要包括民间的交往。
你不喜欢公家的交往？
可以交往，但是也要包括了民间这一部分。
OK。
I believe in the principle of dialogue, but it has to be a all-encompassing dialogue. It has to include critical voices, unofficial writers.
因为大家知道，如果仅仅是跟一个官方在打交道的话，我们根本不能代表，也不能知道中国社会是个什么完整的样子。Because
if you restrict this dialogue to state-approved views, it's impossible to see the whole picture.
因为一个社会，它必须有它的这个很多的面，这些面如果不出现的话。
There has to be an awareness for the multitude of different voices, of different layers, of different perspectives in the literary world for it to be a beneficial.
特别是在一个言论不自由的国家,
especially in a nation that does not respect freedom of expression.
大家看这个照片, 你们猜一下这是在干什么?
Have a look at this photo. Guess what's happening here?
这就是中国作家协会第八次代表大会。
This is the 8th plenary session of the Chinese Writers Association meeting.
坐在前面的是胡锦涛、温家宝，中央所有的领导。
On the front row is Hu Jintao, Wen Jiabao, all the top Politburo leaders.
后面可能是你们喜欢的作家，什么王安忆啊、莫言什么。
Behind them is writers you may have heard of, such as Wang Anyi.
你们敢相信他们说的话吗?
How can you trust the views of people who would sit behind and applaud?
我的意思，当我们在讨论中国作家的时候，我们忘了中国作家其实也是中国共产党的很重要的一部分。When
one talks of these writers, you must understand that they are a very important part of the Chinese political state. They are used as many of them.
就是什么是一个很重要的一部分。
Okay, an important part.
对，不是我们想象是作家协会，或者我们作家们自由的写作。
The Chinese Writers Association itself is a very important part of the Chinese political establishment.
在这点，我是非常不同意英国文化协会的观点。他认为中国。 这些官方作家可以代表中国文学。I
do not approve of this statement by the British cultural institutions that say that these writers are representative of the Chinese literary scene.
这样的活动在法兰克福已经出现过一次。We
have already experienced such an event in Frankfurt.
那个活动杨亮也在，我也在，高新建也在，甚至达赖喇嘛的人也在，新疆的这个叫什么？ Repeat 是吧？也都在，比这次活动请的人还更丰富多彩。In
Frankfurt, Yang Yan was there, I was there, a representative from the Dalai Lama was there, a Uyghur, a dissident writer was there. It was a far more broad perspective on.
但是我现在要问，两年过去了，中国社会变得开放了吗？
But in the 2 years since then, has China become more open? Has it become more free?
这种文化交流让中国社会变得更自由了吗?
Has that kind of literary, even that relatively wide literary, has that aided the process of opening up of freedoms within China?
我认为把刘晓波关在监狱里，还有把很多作家关在监狱里面，我们在搞这么一个所谓的文学活动。
It makes me extremely uncomfortable that such a literary event is being held at a time when Liu Xiaobo and the others are in prison. I think the British public would have a hunger, a thirst to hear a plurality of voices.
Thank you very much. I'm sure there are lots of questions and thoughts and comments and ideas. I would just, yeah, there is, if we're good to go, let's go, yeah, let's make a start. So do you want to bring the mic down? We'll begin here in the corner, although I'm sure you
can hear my voice.
Your voice, yes.
Actually, I can reassure, as an American exile of Vietnam and England, I can reassure Mahjong that there are similar Gulliver and Lilliput problems for an American here. But I actually wanted to compare the two censorship questions in terms of Lian's very, very important question about the web. In a First Amendment environment, people have different ways of reading the web. for Chinese living with the fear, the censorship, all the problems that are attached to the web, and how much censorship still is there on the web. It's probably completely censored, but there probably still is information. Lian says it's a great instrument. How does a Chinese, an ordinary Chinese, tell the difference between truth and lies? How much fear does he feel going on the web when he's looking at information? How well trained are they by this situation to make these separations of truth and lies?
中国人能不能翻取他们能不能区别什么是真实的什么是假的他们是否害怕而且他们有没有学会怎么区别真实和假的东西这个是非常麻烦的一个问题因为通过互联网这种封锁中国其实跟我们或者准确的讲吧中国之外和中国已经变成了两个不同的思维方式
The constraints now on the The constraints now placed on the censorship, the control of the Chinese internet, has created a state where there are utterly two different ways of thinking between the China and the West.
你现在跟中国的作家，二十天以后，他们的演讲，你会问他们一个问题，关于人权的，关于自由的，关于民主的，他们会嘲笑你。
If you ask some of these China's state-approved writers what their opinions on democracy, on human rights, on freedom are, and they will laugh at you.
他们会认为一个作家，你怎么会问一个作家这样的问题？政治很像是一个苍蝇，我关上门，它就进不来了，不影响我的写作。They might view
politics as an annoying insect that buzzes outside their room. They choose to close the door and ignore it.
当然，在一个政治恐惧的一个社会，你会发现人们的思维方式也受到了一个很大的影响，就是说我们都不要介入到任何政治。至于政治是什么，其实没有人清楚。
And in a climate of real political fear and terror, people develop a very warped sense of a warped psychology of thinking, and there is a fear that grows up, a fear of touching these sensitive topics, a fear of politics itself. So that 就是他们不愿意查这些东西，是这个。So there's not there. You will find that even these topics are deleted from through internet censorship. Deleted from the public debate, but there's not even a thirst among many people to go and explore them, to touch them.
如果你问中国的刘晓波的问题，如果你问中国的艾薇薇的问题，那么中国的作家会回答你的很清楚，就是说，活该。If
you ask these writers what their opinion on Ai Weiwei is or Liu Xiaobo is, their plight, they will come, they will reply to you.
They deserve it. 对，那我还没有说完。那么这里边还有一个最大的一个问题，互联网的这种控制，很可能把就是说，它本来的目的是要控制中国人、控制民众，但是最后你发现，比如说我前两年我去过广西一些小城市，那些市长和市委宣传部的一些领导们一块吃饭，因为朋友介绍的，你会发现。 互联网把他们也控制了，因为他们看的那个互联网也是被控制的互联网，所以最后你会发现，我不知道文家宝看的网是不是也是被控制的，最后你会发现大家的想法，他们的想法都是一致的。So
this control of information is extremely pernicious. Well, the Chinese government, their aim is to limit the amount of information that the Chinese public get, but it has all-encompassing consequences. 2 years ago, I had I shared the meal with sort of officials in remote province of China, and through their discussions, I realized that they too, their knowledge of the world, their information was restricted as well. And I wonder whether Hu Jintao himself actually knows, is allowed to know the true picture.
我的意思，这种审查其实包括在座的不是有些年轻的留学生，包括他们出来之后，他们也在看新浪网，他们还在那个思维里边，不会跳出来。
And what a phenomenon one finds is that even when the Chinese young students come and they move abroad and they're in an environment where they are do have free access to the internet, there is not they will continue to read the Chinese state censored internet. There is a sense of comfort within that zone, and they even in the freedom of the West are afraid to transgress those walls.
我想，最后一句，我想能够在这个讲座的人，可能起码跟我们有一种观点的接近，但是你们要小心点，你们跟中国人接触的话，他们会有一句很强的一句话，你怎么老是说我们中国的阴暗面？
I think probably people in this room have a similar way of share a similar attitude towards the world. But when you talk to the Chinese people, and ask these questions, they will come back and say, "Why are you so obsessed with the dark side of China? Why?"
因为他们的思维方式已经被改变了。
Because of this is a product. This is a result of the very restricted worldview they are allowed to get.
Li Jianhong, would you agree that Chinese internet users would prefer to live in a kind of cotton wool cage where they're protected from difficult truths or ideas? Or would you disagree with Marjan's analysis?
<音>刚才马建先生说的观点，我基本上都同意。另外，我可以给他做一些补充。前面那位先生他问，就是比如说中国的网民，他们在网上是不是能区分那些信息真的假的？我认为很多人他是不具备这种区分能力的。最跟中国目前一直在推行的那种教育体制，包括这个国内的那个官方的宣传，因为比如说我们从小接受的那一套教育。 我记忆中大概是从初中开始，就是你说初中、高中到大学，一直到研究生，都要开政治课，就是要学马列主义哲学，然后政治经济学，就宣传他们的那个共产主义社会主义那套思想。
I more or less agree with what Majin said, and I'd like to add a little bit, especially for what that man just said recently, about whether netizens can tell what is true and what is false. I think that they are unable to tell what the difference is, and the reason is that stems from Chinese education and also publicity and or propaganda. Our education system is such that ever from the very beginning, from middle school all the way until university and postgraduate work, you always have to take classes in politics. And that would include political theory and political economy, socialism, etc.
这样一个孩子，你从你的成长期，你在学校阶段，就接受反复接受的就是这一套灌输。这个，到你日后形成自己的思维方式的时候，影响相当大。像我们这些人后来可以说跟官方发生冲突的，有了自己独立思考的，那我们说的也都有一个吐出狼来的过程，就是，可能因为生活中是自己的经历啊，或者什么事件引发，就突然开始怀疑官方的那一套宣传、那一套教育方式。
So when you're a child in school, you're constantly being bombarded with all the official views, and it's very difficult to get a new idea. By the time you're grown up, you're almost too old to start changing all of your opinions. And you could say that people like Ma Jian and myself have more independent thoughts, but it took either a very, very long process or it took a sudden event that suddenly made you doubt everything that the government told you and suddenly made you change your mind.
但是这样一个自我觉醒、独立的过程是非常困难、非常艰难的，有时候也非常痛苦。遗憾的是，我认为很多中国人他终身都沉浸在共产党给他编织的那个幻觉当中，可能一直都没有觉醒。包括马建先生刚才提到的，很多已经在西方，比如说在欧洲、在美国生活很多年的华侨，他提起来还是 就觉得共产党好啊，社会主义好啊。你看我们中国现在多强大啊！清朝的时候被帝国主义欺负，共产党带领中国呢走向富强，走向强大，就这种观点。So
I think that the process of self-awakening is both difficult and painful. A lot of people, it's quite a shame that even people who, oh crap. The self-awakening process is very difficult, and even people who live in the West for a very long time, they constantly have these ideas. They're stuck in the cage of that has been built by the Communist Party, and so that means they're constantly going to say, socialism is great, and the Chinese Communist Party is also great. Think about how strong our country is now, and then think about all the things that happened in the Qing Dynasty. Obviously, we're doing better now than we were then.
我还可以举一些具体的例子，比如说上世纪八十年代之前，就是文革没有结束的时候，那时候中国跟外界是完全分离，那有很多国民呢就虔诚的相信中国是世界上最好的国家。哎呀，美国人民、欧洲人民，包括台湾人民，他们生活在水深火热之中，他们需要我们去解放、去拯救。For
example, let me give you a specific example. In the 1980s, during the Cultural Revolution, China was very closed. And so many, many people thought that China was the best country in the world. And they said, oh, the US, Europe, even Taiwan, they all live in a horrible place and they're not nearly living, they're not living as well as we are, and we need to save them.
到后来因为中国逐步开放了，和外界也可以自由往来了，那么现在仍然相信，中国呢是世界上最好、最强大的国家，比美国、比欧洲都强的，这种人比较少了。但是其他的一些事情，很多人还是 一直受官方灌输的那种思维定式影响，比如说我再给一个事例，关于达赖喇嘛。那因为，中国官方在国内对于达赖喇嘛的一些妖魔化的宣传，所以很多年轻人，他根本也就是，比如说国外的一些网站可以查到达赖喇嘛公开发表的一些言论，但是他们也根本不看这些资讯，因为需要通过那种翻墙软件之类的。
他们就相信官方那一套宣传，说达赖喇嘛就是50年代一个西藏奴隶主的头子，反叛中国逃出来了。那么现在呢，就一直在煽动中国独立，煽动闹事。包括最近期出现的藏人自焚，那么我个人是觉得非常痛心的。那官方的宣传说也是在达赖喇嘛在背后蛊惑，那他们这些年轻人就相信官方那一套说法，说这些人是受了达赖喇嘛的煽动，至少是受他那种思想的蛊惑去参与这种
So later China has become more open, however the situation is still the same. There are fewer people that say that China is the best country in the world and in all respects it's better than the US and than Europe. However, there's still many, many people that are being influenced by the official line, by the official views. Let me give you another example, the Dalai Lama. Chinese government has its view on it, and a lot of young people will say the exact same thing that they hear from the official government. There are essays out there about what the Dalai Lama actually thinks, and technically, if people know how to use their online tools, they can get around the blocks on websites, and they should be able to read what the Dalai Lama actually thinks himself. But the young people, they just say, oh, the Dalai Lama, he's a guy from the 1950s, and he's against China, and he just lives, you know, somewhere in the hills. He's not important. Basically, what they're saying is that the Dalai Lama is against China, and they're only repeating that because that's what the officials have told them.
Thank you. Let's get some more questions. I'm sure there's, I can see a bunch of hands up now. Let's go right to the back, black and white, stripy top.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. A very interesting question. I'd just like to make a statement, and then I would like to ask my gentleman to come to Hong Kong or something. So I would just like to say that the writers who are coming to London in a couple of weeks' time, I had a lot of conversations with them. I don't necessarily recognize exactly the picture that Rajan has depicted, and I've certainly had conversations about Lao Zhuo and Ai Weiwei, and we've had a lot of discussion with a lot of different viewpoints. I'd like to state that. I wonder if I could just ask him to clarify something. He said that after Frankfurt, he didn't feel that anything had changed as a result of that. And so my assumption is that he, you said, did he think it was a bad idea for China to be the market post at the London Book Fair? So would I be correct in assuming that he's having nothing to do with it, that he would not want to be involved in any way?
他就说，第一他要说明，他跟。I mean, Susie, should I introduce you, or would you? Yes, Susie Nickman is Director of Literature at the British Council.
Okay.就是那个英国方面，英国政府，然后那个英语，做这个书展，他说他的那些亲的那些中国作家，他经常的他们谈话也会提到留学国，也会提到这个问题。
他就问你一个问题，就是你说了，因为Frankfurt就失败了，没有把中国变得更自由。你是因为这个就拒绝参加伦敦书展？那伦敦书展，我当然我会去。不是你没问题。啊，那个是他的问题，我是说我会去看。但是要说明，他以为你。
你是拒绝你被请的，不拒绝去，就是。Okay,
so the fact is he hasn't been invited to take part in the Chinese at the book fair, but he would very much like to attend, and he plans to be there as a visitor.
我会买很多这个关于翻译的一些书，关于翻译的一些作品，去书展买书。Okay.
翻译到什么？翻成中文的。Oh, I will go there myself to buy books that the Chinese are bringing over.
我也会去买很多中国菜谱。Maybe
some recipe books.
大家看看这个照片，我想你们能够看得见，这是做些闭幕的时候的一场演出。当然，他也会到伦敦来。 但是你没有注意这个字，你帮忙翻一下，叫努力建设社会主义文化强国。Okay,
this is the closing ceremony of the last Writers Association, and this is the final thing. And you can see from the banner behind says, actively strive to establish a strong socialist culture, a country with a strong socialist culture.
那么伦敦书展就是他们要建一个强国的一部分。And
the London Book Fair will be used by the Chinese authorities to achieve this aim of being a cultural superpower.
无论这个书展发生了什么事，比如说我马健去了，我会说为什么不让我进到中国，或者说还会有别的事情发生，但是到了中国，大家会发现。
Maybe I will attend as an independent visitor, and I will ask some of these officials publicly, why is it that you don't allow me to return to China? Maybe there will be such controversial little sparks, but you can guarantee that none of that will be reported back in China, and that this event will be used for propaganda purposes. As a way to show that China is now becoming a cultural superpower.
昨天我上网专门看了一下，在法兰克福书展官方的报道。Yesterday,
I looked up what the reports were back, what the official reports back in China were of the Frankfurt Book Fair.
有一段非常有意思，他说这些外国人，就是你们啊，经常会提一些非常奇怪的问题。
They would say those foreigners. By that they meant you. Some of them would ask some very strange questions.
而我们的作家充满了这个智慧和机智，都把他们给回答过去了。And
with great wisdom and elegance, our writers were able to defend themselves.
我们坚信我们这个作家的团队是爱党爱国的。
We believe that this team of writers that we sent are love the country, love the party.
我想二十天以后你们去跟他交流吧。You see
what happens 20 days from now, whether this kind of.
我非常希望的一点就是说，真正的交往是要面对一个人的，不是面对一个国家的。
比如说你们请来陈希我杨念经常搞很多诗歌活动，把一些作家叫来，让他们听听英国人是怎么看一个文学怎么成长、怎么互相学习，或者说一个国家怎么去通过作家的笔把它描述出来，这种交往才有意义。我认为一个纯粹的官方的交往，当然了，我们从这里边设法找到一些官方作家有一些独立的东西，有一些美妙的东西，但是我认为。
I don't believe that such events that are conducted within that are organized on official levels that cooperate with the Chinese official bureaucracies can help open up things. I fully support all efforts to improve dialogue between nations, but I believe they should not be used as political power games. That they should be independent. that they should be a meeting of individuals, not a meeting of political institutions. And that Chinese writers of all different persuasions should be invited over, and there should be a genuine dialogue between on a literary basis and not a political one.
因为真正改变一个社会是要靠像欧牛这样的人，要靠这些在中国社会生活着，他们不断的给这个社会在冲撞这个社会的人，在给这个社会提出问题的人。
The real way of helping a country change it relies on people like Owning, people who act individually, who set up publications of those who are hitting those who are knocking against those walls, who are asking questions, who are asking the difficult questions.
现在我来回答你的问题，很多中国作家，你可以跟他们聊天聊得很好，我想可能是在吃饭的时候。
I think you'll find you'll be able to have many interesting conversations with these writers come over, but it will be in the restaurant afterwards, after the talks are finished.
他们的言论可能比我还更开放。Perhaps
they'll be saying things that even I haven't dared, so they will be even more open than
但是当你问问他这些观点，我可不可以发表的时候，他最好要距离你就变远了。
But if you come down to asking, can I publish the record of what you said, they will back away.
我想书永远是一个非常了不起的东西，尽管它已经被变成了一种国际政治在交往，但是作为我一个作家来讲，只要有书展能够让我进去买到书，永远是一种快乐。
I think books are a wonderful thing. I honor, I cherish books, and wherever there are books, I will want to go in and read them and buy them.
我喜欢作家，但是我不喜欢那个叫新闻出版署的领导到这里来，因为他是给刘晓波定罪的人。
I approve of any writer. I would not disapprove of any writer coming to. To any Chinese writer coming abroad, what makes me uncomfortable, what I disapprove of, is people like the head of GAP coming here. These people who are implicated in the imprisonment of people like Liu Xiaobo.
因为跟我谈话的警察跟我说的。跟我谈话的警察说的非常清楚，我们不懂文学，你们那些写的那些破小说，我们也从来没看过。
Okay, the police who cross-questioned him, they said to him, we know nothing about literature. We never read those rubbish novels that you write.
那么真正给这些作家定罪的就是新闻出版署，而这个人带着21个作家要到伦敦来，你们自己判断。And
the people who sentenced these, who accuse writers, who are part of the process of silencing and imprisoning writers, these are the very officials who are bringing over the 21 writers who will be attending.
Sorry, very
long. No, it's very fascinating, rich answer. I don't know, Susie, if you want to say anything briefly.
Just to confirm that you will be at the events at Blackwell's in Oxford on Wednesday evening, because I know a lot of people are looking forward to it.
刚刚去了一点点，不是。
OK 啊，你是我通过翻译我知道，我背景是放在了这个牛津大学有一个活动。OK， 我会去跟中国作家们见面谈问题，这是我非常高兴的，因为任何问题只能通过交流。但是我是说没有请我，是在大会场里面，他们当然不希望我这样作家出现。
Okay, yes, I'm always pleased to be invited anywhere. I'm very happy to be going to Oxford, but the fact remains that what I'm saying is I've not been invited into the main hall. And there is a feeling that people such as myself are not welcome there.
Okay, I think there have been several hands up. We're into the last 5 minutes, so just a brief point here, please. Yes.
The Frankfurt Book Fair at the time took a very clear decision to allow a plurality of views from Chinese, from all sides. From reading the press, it would seem that neither Reed, who run the London Book Fair, or the British Council, who are associated with the London Book Fair, support such plurality. Do our guests, and even does the chairman, think this might be the case?
We can touch on that in the wrapping up. I think we've talked quite a lot about Book Fair. I wonder if there's any other separate points we might just bring into the mix. I can see a couple of hands towards the back. Gentleman in the blue and white checked shirt there. Yes, yes.
I think Deng Xiaoping has actually promised that Hong Kong will stay the same for 50 years. It seems that Hong Kong is still the safe haven for publishing and the distribution of banned books in China. So do you think, given that things, the dynamics of politics are changing in Hong Kong constantly, do you think this so-called promise will change in terms of publishing and distribution of literature that's actually proscribed in China?
Thank you.
Good question about book and book.
Yes, I think maybe one more point right at the back. I saw another hand.
You mentioned that you wrote some love stories, and I guess my question is, to what extent is literary censorship from sex still dominant, as it perhaps was when you wrote Stick Out Your Tongue on the Disc? As far as I remember, and if it is still widespread, why do they still buy that idea, that sexual liberty encourages
Okay, and I think one more question from the lady at the front, Rowan, if you don't mind.
I wanted to ask, you have four children. How old are they?
10.
Oh, right. Have they been home to China?
No.
So we were all going home last summer, but were prevented. Right. But
I'm wondering, stand everything on its head. There are four children having grown up outside, and they go back to their homeland, their country. How do you think they will be affected by what's happening? What are they bringing to China? What is China going to bring to them?
It's very interesting.
It just seems to me an extraordinary. I want to know both sides.
I suppose what I'd like now is in the last few minutes, if both speakers could try and wrap up. There are actually some quite big questions there. I'm sorry we didn't get to them sooner. The permissibility of writing about sex, the nature of Hong Kong as a safe haven, how long will that continue? A return to the question of the plurality of voices at London Book Fair. And finally, I suppose, actually quite a big question, which I would boil down to, kind of, is it worth it? Is this price to pay for being an independent voice, the price that it may exert on one's family, loved ones, is it worth it? I think really it's up to you how you want to address those questions.
I'm not only thinking about it now.
Let's just let the speakers come back. Thank you.
I gather everyone else is having this question interpreted as well. Sorry,
okay, let's finish. 其实不仅仅是这个小说里边表现的什么黄色，或者说是西藏的一个敏感的问题。
So the reason that the official reason for the banning of the stick out your tongue was that it was pornographic, or that it showed the Tibetans in a non-socialist light.
其实最主要的问题还是你在小说里边表达了你个人的自由。
What they were really afraid of in that book is an expression of an individual's the expression of this of a sensibility for freedom, this feeling that there was this a desire for freedom.
这在共产党眼里就是这个人已经很危险。
And it's that put me in a dangerous person category.
还有一个问题就是，我有了四个孩子，我现在又回不了中国。 这种代价对我到底有多大的冲击？
Yeah, and as far as having the four children and the price that I've had to pay is not being able to return, not allowing them to connect with half of their heritage.
我想现在因为有了这个互联网，比如说我跟我妈，我可以直接叫什么视频聊天。
Of course, you can retain contact through Skype.
Yeah, 这是当然了，最大一个代价就是我跟我的母亲，可能就变成了一种人质。So
the consequence, the price I've had to pay for my writing is that in my relationship with my family, with my with my mother, I feel that I have become I am a human hostage, and she is there as a
星期一，星期一我去了中国大使馆，又做了一个申请。我他们也接待了我，我跟他们讲得很清楚，我说按照中国人的传统，我们请遵守中国人的传统，我要尽孝，只要我母亲还活着，希望我能够回去，这变成了我唯一的一个理由。
On Monday, I had a meeting at the Chinese embassy, continually trying to find ways of being able to be allowed back in. And the last reason I could use to them to try and convince them to let me back in was that China has this great tradition of filial piety, and that to prevent a son from going and seeing his mother is the worst punishment you can give somebody.
但是有一点，我觉得这是一个逻辑。 我的痛苦进不去的痛苦，比那些像维瑟这样的作家，他们那些出不来的作家的痛苦，我自己的感觉是他们超过了我。But
I'm very aware that the pain I feel about not being able to return is insignificant when compared to the pain of those people in China who are either not allowed to leave, or like writers like Wurzel, the Tibetan writer, are not allowed to leave their own house or under house arrest. So
我的意思就是说，我们必须享受自由。
So everyone has a right. Every writer, wherever they are, should have the right to live in freedom.
尽管文学是一个虚构的。
Even though literature is in the realm of the abstract.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Li Jianhong, has this been a price worth paying for you to have your independence?
I'd like to add something that's very important to me and right in line with what Majin's been saying. An extremely important event happened in my life last